Hello, Facebook Live. You asked for this. Remember, you asked for it. You wanted an all sideband show. So that's what you're getting. Okay, let me get rid of this. And I don't have the reach for this. Oh, maybe I do. This is Ham Radio Now. It's going to be episode... Do I have the reach for this? 338. Or did I screw that up last time? I said 397. I said it twice in a row. And someone caught it, and I didn't catch it until I was finishing it up for YouTube. So, screwed it up. 338 to fix it. Volume 2. Fix it revisited. And, I'm not really set up for doing this one-handed very well. I'm Gary Pierce, KM4AQ. As long as we're doing this, Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. If you enjoy the programs, stop by hamradionow.tv, the world's best, no, the world's, the most important amateur radio program on the internet. Stop by hamradionow.tv, click the big. It is legal for me to be doing this, even though it, you know, it seems like I'm talking on the air, because I'm going into a dummy mode. So, if you remember from Fix It, Volume 1, or the original Fix It show, the main purpose of the original Fix It show was to repair the tuning knob, the optical encoder behind the tuning knob on my Icom 7000. And that was successful. It's been working fine in all the heat and sunlight and all that here in North Carolina. It's been working just fine. So the second thing we looked at was this microphonic sounding thing. That wasn't the shot I wanted. There's the shot. Some ringing, and also some ringing in the audio. We also had some hum, and if you listen carefully, you hear a little bit of warbling. I still got some hum, and I got a different power supply. Totally different. Different power supply, so I don't think the power supply is the problem. And Jeff had said you could just stick an AC voltmeter on the power supply and see if it's got ripple. But I've taken a voltmeter and put it in AC, and I see about 12 volts worth of AC on three different power supplies here. So that's going to be a little bit more search. But this is interesting. If I move the dummy load over there, it gets a lot worse. It sounds pretty terrible. And if I move it on over here, it cleans up some. But there's still some warble. Okay, so still got the pinging, right? Well, this is a totally new, different... I didn't buy a new one, I borrowed one. Totally different Icom 7000. This is... stop that. Oh, there we go. This is my friend's Jerry's 7000. It's his spare. He's got two. And I wanted to find out if he had the same problem. Now, what I'm going to do here is go to the original Fix-It episode and play what that sounded like so we can actually compare. So let me get off the air here.
Yeah, there's the issue.
Oh, there's that pinging. What is that pinging?
Yep. Don't know, but it's interesting.
Yep. So
it's the slightest tap.
Initially, I thought that was something in the microphone, and
Okay, so that's what that sounded like. This one's a little bit different. Depends on where I tap on the mic. On that one, pointing over like you can see it, on that one, no matter where I hit the mic, it got a ping. On this one, it sort of depends on where. It's still not the mic. It's still something else is going on. We also played with the transmit bandwidth a little bit, and so I'm going to play with it a little bit here. We're in the wide mode right now, and I'm going to take a look at the actual numbers in just a minute. We're in the wide mode right now, switch to the mid mode, and it sounds a little bit worse and a little bit more hollow. And switch to the narrow mode, and you can hear a lot of ringing. I don't think I'm in the default positions here, so I'm going to go to the microphone bandwidth. Yeah, okay, so here we go. There's the default bandwidth for narrow, and it's still sounding pretty terrible, and it sounds very hollow. Sounds like I'm talking into an orange juice can. And by the way, we are receiving on the Icom 756.3, and the audio is being piped from that radio into my mixer, so we're not picking up out of the speaker. So back to this radio. And we're looking at the narrow mode. It's at the high end is 2,500 hertz. The low end is 500 hertz. So I'm pretty narrow. And the mid will be, to make sure I got the default set for that, 300 and 2,700 hertz. And the high, getting back to the default, 100 to 2,900. Won't go any higher, no, won't go any higher. It wasn't switching at that point. It won't switch until I do this. Okay, so here is wide. Testing 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Once again, a dummy load, so we're not really on the air. This is wide, and this is mid, and, wide sounds not too bad. I don't really hear much in the way of ringing. In fact, I don't really hear any. Just kind of a little bit there. And mid, yeah, it really sounds. Really sounds ringy. Maybe not so much on my voice, but if I bump things around, you can. Now I'm not even hitting the mic. Just give it a sharp snap in front of the mic, and you can still hear it.
And we'll go to narrow. Now, in narrow, the whole idea is to be able to get your audio punching through a pileup or something, but with as much ringing, playing something like a spring. So that's two radios that are doing about the same thing. Let me play with this bandwidth a little bit. So we'll go to QS. I'm not sure what QS really means, but maybe quality of signal, who knows. We're in the narrow mode, so I'm going to go on down to that. And now you will hear when I make changes, and you can see it on the dial. 2,500 hertz is the high end. We take it up to 2,900. So you can hear that high end roll off. Now this obviously depends to some extent on what you're listening on. Hopefully you're listening on headphones or a good speaker, but if you're listening out of your phone, you're probably not going to hear much change. A little bit of change. And as I noted last time, just because it is in the position that is called narrow, that doesn't mean it has to be narrow.
I can put the total wide parameters in the position that's called narrow. So it's the low frequency end that seems to make the biggest difference. And, you know, the options are 100 hertz, 300 hertz, 500 hertz. Between 100 and 300, not that much difference. But between 300 and 500, a lot of difference. And let's see see what the high end does. So I guess that's kind of what I expect, because it's a very high-pitched ringing. So if we roll off that high end, then most of the ringing seems to go away. Give it high end back. So, but yet if we
go to total narrow, you don't really hear the high ping, but you hear a sproing. Okay, so.
Back to wide. And you hear a good tink, but it's not, it doesn't ring out quite so much. Okay, that is, to me, very similar to, and I wanted to talk into that camera. To me, that's very similar to what I was hearing on the other radio. Maybe a little different, but it indicates to me that it's a default in the radio, at least in two of the Icom radios. But there have been lots and lots and lots of mailing list comments talking about this ringing, and just about all of them agree that if you want to sound halfway decent, you've got to stay with the wide transmit bandwidth. And I don't get any complaints when I do the wide transmit bandwidth. Now, there have also been, my arm's getting tired, there have also been microphone mods. There's one guy in particular that performs microphone mods. The problem is not the microphone, but maybe this still isn't the greatest microphone. So you can do some things that will change the sound of the mic, and you can make these audio adjustments, the fidelity adjustments that I've done, that also make a big difference. So there's a fellow that did a significant test, and he put his results on a website. This is K6WKE, and he had his mic, I guess he did the mic mod himself, and he put the test pre and post modification and then some other adjustments on there. So I've never had the microphone mod done, didn't do it myself, didn't send it out to be done. Let's take a listen to the results that he got. So we'll start with what he's calling the stock mic, unchanged in the wide mode. And let me get myself off of here.
KA6WKE audio test with stock HM151 microphone. Default setting, transmit bandwidth setting wide.
How does he sound compared to me? I don't know. It's hard for me to tell when I'm listening on my phone. So I think he sounded better. Okay, I'm going to play that again, and then I'm going to go immediately to the post modification, and let's see if we can hear a difference. And I won't step in the middle of that this time. So here's the unmodified test first.
KA6WKE audio test with stock HM151 microphone. Default setting, transmit bandwidth setting wide. KA6WKE audio test with modified HM151 mic. Default settings, transmit bandwidth wide.
Okay. And to my ear, and I'm listening on headphones, again, well, listening on headphones now to the website. The modified sounds a little brighter, a little less low end, a little more high end, and maybe a little cleaner. It's not a huge difference, but it's a little bit better. Okay, we'll do the same thing with the mid. I'll get myself out of here and play the back-to-back unmodified and modified mid.
KA6 WKE audio test with stock HM151 microphone. Default settings, transmit bandwidth set to mid. KA6 WKE audio test with modified HM151 mic. Default settings, transmit bandwidth mid. KA6 WKE audio test with stock HM151 microphone. Default settings, transmit bandwidth set to mid. KA6 WKE audio test with modified HM151 mic. Default settings, transmit bandwidth mid.
So listening to his mid settings, the unmodified mic sounds definitely hollow. And the modified mic doesn't sound nearly so hollow. It sounds a little louder, too. It's an improvement. It still doesn't sound great in the mids, but it sounded better. Let's listen to narrow and see how that works out. I'm trying to figure out what buttons to push here. Just because it's a pain to listen to that tin can. Okay, so just some improvement. I still wouldn't use narrow, even with the microphone mods. There's some other things that I want to play with, though. Some other settings that he has worked with and that I have worked with on the Icom 7000. People have had a lot of trouble trying to use speech compression on this radio, and the speech compression is hard to set. I've got the speech compression turned on here, and if you're looking at the meter now, you are seeing I don't have the power turned all the way up, so the power line on the meter is only going up to about 30 watts or so. The ALC is kicking up about like it should, half to three-quarter scale on most voice peaks. You're not seeing anything happen on the compression line. Let me really holler into it. Four. Okay, really hollering into it. Four. Well, it's driving the ALC up into the red, which means it's going to be distorting. But finally, you see a little bit of a little bit of compression action. So let's look at the settings that got there. Turn on compression settings, and you'll notice that the compression level is at 1. So it's one notch above off. And if I turned it up enough to see something happen on the meter, the compression meter, well, let's do that. It's going to take a moment to get myself compression on the meter. Okay, so there's the compression meter. And we'll go back to compression settings. And testing 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, now you can see some compression happening, but it is really distorted. And the background noise is just coming up like crazy. And you're still not seeing that much compression. Testing 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So take the compression back down, and I'll show you why I think that's where it belongs in a moment. So I'll turn the compression off, but that's not going to be a really good test. I want to set the meter back to power output. Okay, so we can see about what kind of power we're putting out here. This is the kind of program that's going to get a lot of people on these in a bunch, because they'll say, I don't know what I'm doing. Turn the compressor off. So let's see, compression is off, testing 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I'll show you a couple of different things. For one thing, you can see that the power output is way down from what things are when the compressor's on. Let's go to the receive end of things and see, let's see what the difference is. This is with the compressor on, testing 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. And that meter's ballistics are kind of slow, so, it's not reading peaks by any means, but we're seeing something in the S5 to S7 range. And let's turn the compression off, testing 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. So, now we're well below S5. If I really honk it, we go back up to the peaks we were seeing before. But if I turn compression on, suddenly I really filled out that signal. However, that's not the only setting that counts. So what other setting counts? Well, the mic gain setting counts. And let's take a look at that. Wow, the mic gain is almost all the way down too. So when I turn compression off, then I really ought to go back to mic gain and crank that up some. So, it's a little bit more fair. And we're seeing, the power output. We are not compressing. We're not filling out the... I was showing you the wrong picture. So, let's try that again. So here's the mic gain. Where we found it was way down here like that. So, really ought to turn it up. And you can see that, the power output peaks are getting more like they're supposed to be. Kind of wish that hum wasn't there, because it kind of makes things more distorted than they really are out of this radio. So you can see the power output is peaking about the same place. And the signal on the meter is coming up about where it was. So, let me do one more thing. Let me take my RF power. Let me take the RF power way down to very little, so there's almost nothing making it to the receiver. Of course, this kind of makes it a more difficult test. Because you can't hear my narration very well. That's a fairly weak signal. And let's see, where have I got the mic gain set? Okay, the mic gain is up pretty high. And now you're seeing things at about S3, S4. If I really kick it up, we'll go up to about S4. So now I'm going to turn the mic gain back down. I've got to remember, I'm the technical director. And I'm going to turn on compression, but I'm going to go back to this picture, so you can see what happens on the S-meter when I turn compression on. Compression is going on now. Testing 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. The whole idea is that the peaks aren't any louder. It's just that the average has come up quite a bit. But it took a lot of finagling to figure out those numbers on this radio, to figure out that the mic gain had to be set really low, and the compression itself had to be set really low. And when both of those turned down, then there's a combination meter. Our ALC is kicking up about where it ought to be. The power output, we're not seeing any because we got the power output turned all the way down. And the compression, nothing. We're not seeing any compression on the meter at all. And those are hard to find parameters, but that's about what you want to do with this radio. So, what? going to go. So what? And I would complain to Icom about the way the audio works on this radio, and I think people did back when it was a production radio, but it's been out of production for a few years. And, you know, this is my version of it. I'm not sure how old Jerry's is, but mine is probably 8 years old, and it's been out of production for maybe 2 years. So they're not even making them anymore. It doesn't make much sense to complain to Icom, but it is interesting to know that at least on these two samples, same problem. More or less. Mine worse. Because it doesn't ping down here. So where could that ping be coming from? Now here is pure speculation. I really can't tell. We know it's not the microphone. Swapped out the mics. Put this mic on other radios. This mic on other radios doesn't cause a problem. This mic on other modes doesn't go ping. So it's not the mic. Something in the radio. And let me go back to one more quick test. I'm going to turn the mic gain back up. And turn off the compression. And doesn't ping quite so much. A little bit. Check, change the bandwidth.
Okay, so we're back in the narrow bandwidth. It's still happening, but it's not as bad. So my conclusion is that compression makes it a little worse. You can't hear it, but there's a thunderstorm going on outside. My show's a track thunderstorm.
Compression makes it a little worse. But it's hard to tell why. As I was setting this radio up, I noticed something else. That one of the connectors had a little bit of crackling to it. I think I may have...
I shut the radio off. Yeah, there's the problem. I just pushed the front panel sideways a little bit.
It's back. Do I remember what I was talking about? Thunderstorm. Actually don't remember exactly what I was talking about, other than that it seems a little bit worse with compression on. And again, no complaints to Icom. Something's wrong. Oh, so what the problem might actually be... Oh, yeah, I was looking for that crackling. That's right, I was pushing the connectors around. But I was noticing when it was crackling and is not crackling anymore, is that when I would get a crackle, the crackle would initiate a ping. And so that wasn't, and it wasn't this end of the connector, it was the end that's down by the radio. Get out of the way, microphone. This end down here. So I'd be wiggling that. I was trying to find out where it was coming from, where the crackling was coming from, so I swapped the connector sides. Now the crackling came up here, but it's not doing that anymore. But the crackling down here was making the radio ping. So more evidence that it was not the microphone itself. So what could it be? This is random, rampant speculation. We think it is somewhere in the circuitry that controls the audio for the sideband transmitter, because you don't hear it on FM, you don't hear it on AM, just in sideband. So somewhere in there, there's some circuitry that controls the audio going into the sideband transmitter. And my guess is that there's a feedback path in there, a very small one, but a feedback path, so that some audio that's going into the transmitter gets fed back into an earlier part of the circuit. And I think it's there's some digital DSP in part of the transmit audio adjustment. And so there's a little bit of delay. And that delay, when you feed some output back into the input, and it you know, heads to the output, back to the input, you know, like a regenerative receiver, it causes, it's not long enough to be an echo, but it's long enough to be a little reverb to make that ping. I'm guessing that was it. Jeff is thinking, you know, it could be something as simple as traces on a circuit board that are too close together. That when the circuit board was designed, they laid it out, and they never really tested for this, and there's some capacitive coupling of the output signal, not the RF output signal, but the output of whatever the audio stage is, back toward the input to some extent. Maybe. Without doing a whole lot more testing, tearing it all apart, sticking scopes in it all over the place, we're not going to know. And the only real reason for doing this is that it's just a curiosity, something that you can learn a little bit from. Even if you don't have a 7000, a little bit of playing with the radios. So one more look at the website from... who's the fellow we're talking about, the KA6KWE. He's also did some adjustments based on what someone recommended, WX7Y, did some compression adjustments, and let me take that up to full screen. He hit the compression a little bit harder than I did. He set the mic gain at, compression about the same, 1 or 2. I set mine at 1. He was setting his mic gain to 30 to 50%. I set mine lower, but it didn't really seem to make much difference. I was driving things as well as they needed to be driven with the compression setting at the mic setting at about 10. And so now I'm going to do another A-B comparison, and this will be... did I show this? Yeah, these are the... just pictures that he took as he was making the mods to the mic. So let me give you the A-B comparison. Modified audio on both sides, but one without any compression and one with. And I'll just go through all six in one swell swoop, and you can see what they sound like.
KA6WKE audio test with modified HM 151 mic, default settings, transmit bandwidth wide. KA6WKE audio test with modified HM 151 mic, default settings, transmit bandwidth wide. KA6WKE audio test with modified HM 151 microphone using WX7Y settings. Transmit bandwidth wide. KA6WKE audio test with modified HM151 mic, default settings, transmit bandwidth mid. KA6WKE audio test with modified HM151 microphone using WX7Y settings, transmit bandwidth mid.
Audio test with modified HM151 mic, default settings, transmit bandwidth narrow.
KA6WKE audio test with modified HM151 microphone using WX7Y settings, transmit bandwidth narrow.
So something to note as you look at least for those of you that are looking at the screen and not just getting the audio, in addition to turning on the compression, he also changed the bandwidth in the mid and narrow modes. In the wide mode, pre and post compression, the bandwidth was 2900 on the high side, 100 hertz on the low side. In the mid position, pre-compression 2700 and 300, post-compression 2900 and 200. Can I set mine at 200? I didn't think I could, but I guess I probably could. And the biggest difference, because his pre-compression narrow sounded terrible, and his post-compression narrow sounded pretty good, but it's because he said his post-compression narrow at essentially the wide settings. Instead of 2500 and 500, he went out to 2700 at 300. So those were the settings that he was told to set, but as a narrow setting, wasn't really narrow. Wasn't going to do for you what you're looking for in a narrow setting, which is to give you a sharp, penetrating signal. So the conclusion here is the Icom 7000 is not really capable of doing a sharp, penetrating signal with or without the microphone mods. It's a rag chew radio. But I still, you know, I break pileups when I'm operating mobile, and I'm trying to work the X or contest or whatever. I break pileups fairly decently. Well, you know, 100-watt mobile with a Tar Heel antenna. It's better than I'd expect. I don't break every pileup, and I don't always make the contact. And if it's a huge pileup and the signal I'm listening to is not that strong, I really don't have much of a chance. But I've gotten through more often than I think I have a right to be able to get through. So I think that is it. Close out this episode. Say goodbye to you guys on Facebook. What the heck? Let me go look at Facebook and it's going to take a moment for me to get there. Let's see if I even have anything going on live. Oh, there it is, because, yeah, this one is still pinned. So I guess I'll unpin that. And now pin the live. Didn't warn anybody that this was coming up, so there's three people watching, one of which is now me, and apparently no comments. All right. That's it. Oh, yeah. Of course. As usual, I do this. Ham Radio Now brought to you by you. If you enjoy the programs, this one did not cost a lot to make, except, you know, still got all the equipment around me. So hamradionow.tv, the advertisement is going through a dummy load. You know, get off my case. We're not on the air. Hamradionow.tv and stop by. Click the pig if you enjoy the program and you want to send some money. This is my job. And got to get rid of everything here. Oh, it did crunch a little bit. Over and out. Will there be anything that comes afterwards? Because, you know, it's only me. What have I got to say? Not much. In fact, nothing.